Welcome back to the World Championship Coaching Series. Today, guess who we have? Mr. Manoj. I know he didn't win it. We were just talking about that, but we were talking about the experiences that we actually got from it. But before we do that, I want to introduce you to Manoj Vasudevan. Did I say that correctly?
Yes, perfect. I couldn't say better.
Yes. All right. You know, I was really worried about that. I got to get his name right. So welcome. So why don't you tell us a little bit about, you know, for the people that may not have been in Toastmasters yet, say, you know, just a year ago, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
All right. So I started Toastmasters pretty late, but even before that, I had intention to become a speaker to at least to pick up my public speaking skills. I used to work in consulting, and in that job, you know, the people who could do presentation, who could connect, communicate, network, lead, sell, these people always had the edge. And I was not born with these skills. And my intention was to, you know, learn this. And I was looking for opportunities to do that. So funny enough, Joel, one of the reasons I wanted to be a speaker was I always dreamed about writing a book.
Really?
I wanted to be an author.
You wrote a book, so tell us about that.
The funny part is, even before I joined, the point was I wanted to write a book. And I thought if I write a book, and I noticed that all the writers are good speakers, or at least the best-selling authors are good speakers. And I said, if I ever write a book, how will I convince someone to buy my book? So that is one of the reasons. Of course, I also was terrified of speaking, and I had to look for platforms to improve my skills. And the third reason was I wanted to be a role model for my children. So because they were growing up like me, shy, introverted, reserved, did not speak up. And you know, no matter how I push them, they're not going to speak. So I wanted to become a role model for them. And that's one of the reasons I picked up public speaking. And I've been happy in all these three areas. Of course, I did write books. I could speak in front of people. And as you said, the largest audience I spoke had 20,000 people in the audience. And of course, my kids also speak. They look forward to speak. So I think I have achieved my initial aim. And then I realized, no, more people can benefit. And I go around the world telling people, you too can be a better speaker. You too can be a better leader. And that's my whole story in a short format.
Okay. So you talked a little bit about, you know, getting involved. Well, what was it that made you get involved in Toastmasters? I was watching videos, and myself, you know, with the business that I had, I wanted to get better at public speaking. It's not that I was afraid of it or anything. I just wanted to get really, really good at it because I wanted to start, you know, giving seminars. And something totally different. I was watching videos, Les Brown, Zig Ziglar, and in the feed, I kept seeing this World Championship of Public Speaking kept popping up. And I was like, Toastmasters, never heard of it. You know, so I knew about it, but it was like maybe months later. So what was it for you that made you actually join?
Okay. So for me, it was not an easy decision. I found the name itself very strange. And then because I once met a person who used to be very shy. And later on, I met this lady again. And she was like highly confident. And I said, what happened to you? And she was always in a hurry, rush to go to some club. And I was curious, what are you going? Why are you so busy? And she told me about the club she is at. And I Googled it up. I went to a club. And that was one of the strangest places I've ever been. Because all the protocols, all the formalities, the rituals of introducing. I said, what is going on? And they invited me to speak. And I said, no. And I came back 8 months later. And I spoke again. I don't know. I was invited to speak again. I didn't speak. Eventually, I joined after about 2.5 years later. So it was not an easy decision to be. So when I say I was nervous to speak or terrified to speak, I mean it. I was. And so even after I joined a club, it took me 8 long months before I summoned the courage to come up in front and deliver my first speech. And that also I took a day when there was only 20 people in the audience. Usually it's a bigger group. Like this was 1/3 the audience size. So yeah, that's where I started. But of course, then what happens is the moment you start to speak up, you notice that the audience responds to you and the people actually have an interaction, conversation with you. And I started to realize my blind spot, and that's where I was so curious to build up this skill. Some people just SMS me saying can't view. I don't know if it's true. Are people watching?
I just sent the link. I put the link on Facebook so maybe they can.
Okay.
They can. Yeah. Okay. So when you said blind spots, what exactly is that?
Okay, perfect. When I did deliver my very first speech, a gentleman came up to me and said, and this was one of the best lessons I've ever learned, is to record all your speeches. And I said, why? It never crossed my mind I had to record myself when I speak. And which was very powerful because it gave me the ability to go back and visit and see how I was and what areas I had to improve. And also when I work with a coach or a mentor, I can show my video and get live feedback. So this was I realized that, it's not just what you speak. It actually what impression you're leaving on your listeners and what they thought about your speech and how you can improve. So yeah, so of course people give you inputs of how they saw it and how they understood it, and which is very important. Yeah, that's what I mentioned, blind spots.
So what was the first conference that you went to? Was it as soon as you got in, or was it a couple of years? Which one?
It was 2 years, maybe 1.5 years later, I went for a district conference. By the way, Joel, some people are SMSing, texting me saying the link is not available.
I just clicked on the link and I saw myself.
Okay.
So it's something that they're not doing right. I just clicked on it.
Okay. It works for you?
Yep. So, okay, we're good.
Okay, so let me close that channel, then I don't get distracted. So yeah, I went for a district conference, and I was a contestant at that time. So one of the reason I went also was, main reason was to compete, but I also benefited from the speakers at the conference who were sharing their experience. And here is what I learned from my father when I was like really young. And one of the things he said is, whenever you see someone speaking, go and listen to them. And he used to look at the daily newspaper, look at what events are going on, and he used to go and turn up at events. And the reason he said is, maybe they are only delivering a 1 hour speech, but they may be sharing a lifetime of experience. So you benefit a lot by just sitting and listening to other people speak, and which I really implement whenever I see someone who I look up to speak or on a subject I like. I definitely turn up. I will be sitting in the front row and listening, always. Wow, so that's
pretty interesting. So anytime, if you know the person or if you don't know the person, anytime someone's speaking, you just go to get that information, is that correct?
I've learned from anyone. And I don't even look at their years of experience or their the accolades. If somebody has something to share in a topic of interest, I will go and I'll be there. I'll do anything to be there. In fact, I have driven 60 miles and 100 miles to listen to 15 minutes. I'm very determined to do that.
Wow. So what was it? Was it a person or was it an event that made you a lifer in Toastmasters? I'm a lifer. I'll probably be a Toastmaster until the day I die. What was it for you? And why are you still in? What was it for you that made you a lifer in Toastmasters?
The one reason is I met people, and I was very fortunate in my journey, and I met mentors and coaches who really helped me and tried to lift me up. And one of the guys who really helped me was Cho Kim. He was the first guy who told me to compete and to take this seriously. And he had this practice of, he said, do your preparation so well that you always get the edge, and should be so prepared. And that really helped me. To put this in context, once I was competing, I was getting very nervous, and because there's a lot of tough competition, they're great speakers, you look up to them and say, wow, why am I even competing? And I went up to a mentor and said, what do you think? I don't think I'm going to, this is a tough competition. He said, and he looked at me and said, no problem, you will win. I said, how do you know I will win? And he said, I said, am I such a great speaker? He said, no, you're not a great speaker, but you put a lot of effort. Most people do not put that kind of effort. And that's what, so he told me a few things which I work on. He says to like have excellence, a habit, to be, to stay coachable. That means when you have blind spot, a lot of people are not coached, because I am now, I coach people all levels of the competition, including the finals, the world championship, public speaking. One thing I realize is a lot of people are not coachable. And what I realize is to be humble and to learn again and again and again, that is what makes a champion. And that's what the champion mindset is all about, to be ready to take feedback. I think as someone said, I don't know who said, I think Ken Blanchard, no, feedback is the breakfast of champions. So wow. I believe that gives you a big edge. And that's something I wanted to share.
Wow. Okay. So we were kind of talking about this a little earlier, but let's take some time and go over this. You didn't win the world championship, but what has, not only that, the, you know, the 2015 finals, but, you know, just Toastmasters since you started up until that, your whole Toastmaster journey, what has this done for you business-wise as well as personal? What has it done for you?
All right. Now, business-wise, I don't think it's not, a, it was not, so like, let me correct, people have a different perception about the world championship, and I too had the same thing. A lot of people look at world champions and believe these people are millionaires and making tons of money, you know, and living. So what we need to understand is the world championship of public speaking, you don't get a Rolls Royce, you don't get a trip around the world, maybe you do get some invites, but there's no money, there's no cash component. So if you look at it as a business, I think you're going to be very disappointed. And I'm personal friends with a lot of world champions. I know from the, I don't know them at a very personal level. I text them and talk to them, meet them, have lunch. But the point is, you need to understand this is something else. It was Craig Valentine who said ever when he won the world championship of public speaking, the first thing he did was to buy a book on public speaking. Right, and that's the kind of champion I want to be, because I also want to like learn. And if you look at all the world champions, they actually are still working on and building. So money wise, it's actually a continuous effort. Business wise, because it's all by. Let me tell you very straight: becoming a world champion of public speaking will not bring you lots of money. There are lots of work to be done, and lots. So what does this do for you? Is that you look at this? You have a goal to aim for. You have something. You're aiming at something. This you, and you also learn how to write a speech more efficiently. Usually when you are delivering a speech, you deliver a speech, people applaud, you get a couple of feedback, you walk away, and you never look at the speech again. Now, what the contest does for you is that you write a speech and you take your best speech and make it better. And you do it over and over and over again, and you get a habit, and then when you realize the little things that matter, and that's what enriches you. And that's the edge. A little, no, I always tell this little story I heard from somebody else, is that, you know, in a horse race, let's say assume there's a race, the winning horse and the horse that comes second may not win by a huge margin. Maybe the first horse that goes, the finishes the crossing line, his nose is just like the tip of the nose is ahead of it, and it wins. So, but the second horse actually lost. But doesn't mean it's a bad horse. And the point is, it's a little edge that matters. But again, just because you came, you didn't win, doesn't mean you're a bad speaker. And actually, one thing I realized after winning or participating in the World Championship of Public Speaking, one thing I realized is a lot of people do not know about the World Championship of Public Speaking outside of Toastmasters. You go to somebody in the street and say you're a world champion, is it, they have a championship for that? You know, people do not realize. And but within the community, of course, there is a lot of recognition, acknowledgement, and you meet people. But again, I always say, remain humble and keep learning, because otherwise there is no hope. And there is not a lot of money, of course, but there is an opportunity there because you are a better speaker, which you can have even without winning the world championship public speaking. It's interesting, Joel, you mentioned about Les Brown. Do you know he was a member?
I heard he was a member.
Did he win the world championship public speaking?
No, he did not.
Do you know he competed?
No, I didn't know that.
Yes, he competed and he was kicked out after the district level. Right?
Really?
And I don't think he regrets that because he's doing very well. And so the point is, it's not really the trophy you are after and the ability to stretch yourself and grow and look at your best speeches and make it better and better. And of course, in fact, Toastmasters called him back to give him the Golden Gavel Award, if I'm right. That's what I read. And this is the kind of speakers. So it's actually not really about winning the competition, actually your ability to send positive message out to the world. And this unique ability to have that speech with such an efficiency and accuracy and precision, and you will otherwise may not spend that kind of time in writing a speech. And that, there's no right or wrong, but that's what I learned.
So you came in the beginning to wanted to be a better role model for your kids, and you were kind of on the shy side. So what is the big difference now? Are you still that same person?
See, I'm inherently shy, introverted. I get manner, but I'm also, I made a conscious decision to meet people and network with people. And as I mentioned in my book, there are five core skills we need to have to be successful: the ability to connect, to communicate, to network, to lead, and to sell. And these are the areas I realized were areas for improvement for me, and I've worked on that. It's always working, we are all work in progress. But I know I can do a lot of things better than I used to because I made a conscious, deliberate, focused effort to build on these skills. And I believe anyone who has the same determination can be better than me. And I have students who are doing much better than me. So, and that's the way I want it to be. And there's no surprise because anyone who realizes the why they want it, as they say, the bigger the why, the smaller the how.
Right. So, what has been your high point in your whole Toastmasters journey?
Oh, a few high points, but one of the best things I remember, so some victories are very special. One special event I loved was when I won the district championship for humorous speech contest. And I was not a funny person. And the previous year, in the previous contest, I was not even placed at the club level. So in the club level I competed, I was not first, second, or third. And I was absolutely no trophy. It's not that I didn't do hard work. I did hard work. I went to all the seminars and workshops. And I knew the techniques, but I was not placed. I was totally devastated because I had spent lots of time, sacrificed family time, I stayed away from parties and things to focus on my script, and still I didn't even win at the club. It really lit a desire in me to really master humor. So I spent the next 1 year determined to win the humorous speech competition. I won, and hands down, because I had a 7-minute speech with 60 laughters. And the only reason I could do it, yeah, this was a really powerful speech. At that time, of course, I got to that because I also made mistakes in that speech. But at that time, it was good. But the reason was I was going after people and testing my speech, getting the qualified feedback. People who had been there, done that, and that gave me the edge. And I put my, so once I did that, I got so confident. And that took me in a different trajectory. Someone came to me and said, "Oh, Manoj, you're so good. Can you coach me on stand-up comedy?" I said, "What? I never done stand-up comedy. It's not my cup of tea." And they said, "Oh, no, no, this is one guy, and Karan. And he, you are a funny guy." I said, "I'm a funny guy?" So, I saw you speak. I said, "Really? Okay, never mind." He gave me his script. And I looked at his script, and this is what I blurted out. I looked at his script and say, what do you expect people to laugh? And this was like something that came out of my head. I said, "What do you mean?" I said, "No, usually when I write a script, I write in a certain way where I indicate." And I helped him to do his first open mic, the debut. And he did a good job. And he asked me to do stand-up comedy. because he said, you're so good, you don't realize how good you are, you should do. I said, why do you think? Then I realized, looking back, my effort I did in helped me get certain insights and expertise and competence in, or proficiency in getting the little things work, the humor work. So he got me in the open mic. It so happened that that segment was in eventually telecast in Comedy Central Asia. I got invited to the International Comedy Festival in Hong Kong. I was among the top 25 stand-up comedians there. And I said, wow, you know, worth things can take. Of course, I didn't pursue that path because that was not my original intention. I wanted to stick focused to my five core areas, which I said, to connect, communicate, network, lead, and sell. But again, I stretched myself and I realized it's possible. And I realized stand-up comedy, with all humility and transparency, I believe stand-up comedy is a lot easier than winning the humorous speech contest. Because really? People are already primed to laugh. They come there to laugh. And some of them are drunk. They laugh anyway. but I'm not demeaning. I know stand-up comedians who do a lot, tons, but I learned a lot of techniques from stand-up comedy, from crowd work, from some of the best people in the world watching. Because as I wrote the scripts, I watched people. I turned up for mic. I spent like 6 months just watching comedians. Then I went to do my open mic. That's why I was successful. It's not that I just woke up one day and delivered a gig and I was famous. No, I actually did the hard work, watching every single person everywhere they go and learn techniques. This is a lot of techniques, but I realized, hey, once you learn the techniques, not that difficult. Because one of the things comedians do is that they take the best stuff and then what doesn't work gets mercilessly thrown away. And that's why sometimes I have my best jokes in my script, and sometimes it doesn't work. My coach says, throw it out. I said, that's my best joke. He said, throw it out. Okay, then I had to like throw it out. You know, it can't be attached to that because it just doesn't work. So we keep what it works. That was a good thing, yes.
Now, you were talking about techniques. I know there's a lot of techniques that you can use for humor. And I want to talk to you about your final speech in 2015. Okay. And you started off with a callback on Neha's girlfriend. I'm thinking to myself, I don't know if I would have had the balls to even try that. When did you decide that you were going to do that? Because that was like, that had us, you know, from the moment of go.
That's a very brilliant, I get brilliant question, actually. And I hear that all the time. One reason I realized, and I tell you this, Joel, see, when I started speaking initially, remind me of this question again if I go off track, but what I realized when I started speaking initially in speaking, I go on stage and speak, I don't see anybody in the audience because I'm in my script and I deliver my script, I go. I look at people, I don't see anybody. I look at people, I don't see anybody and I walk away. Over the year, I realized one thing that makes you work in connection is to be there 100% of the time. You're 100% present. You are in the moment, sharing an experience with the audience. And one of the things I say, when you are in front of an audience, there is no past. You don't think about, oh, I could have done that. I could have prepared more. I could have done. No, there is no future. That means you don't think what people are going to do. Am I going to screw up? Am I going to make mistakes? Are people going to say something? There's only the now, only the present. And you be 100% focused on the present, you connect. So what I did was I was paying attention to all other speakers. I was paying close attention to all other speakers. And one reason I realized the speaker before me, Aditya Maheshwaran, he was actually speaking on a similar topic. He's an Indian guy. He's speaking about his girlfriend, a car and all this. I said, my goodness, this audience is going to look at this. There are two Indians on the stage telling about the same thing. And I had to be on the moment to differentiate. So I wanted to tell them upfront, this is not the same story. This is a different story. So the guts I had to do that, this came from not from the speaking. It came from being a master of ceremony.
Wow.
Yeah. So as I said, I tried everything. I tried speaking. I tried stand-up comedy. I tried emceeing. I did everything possible to be a better speaker. So one thing I learned in being a master of ceremony was to be in the moment, to look at what's going on and react on the, in the moment. Invited, like, so I actually teach a program called the Certified Master of Ceremonies program. And I think it's one of the unique programs in the world, because I teach people off, come coach them, then I should mentor them for 6 months to be an MC, because I realized that's a one great things, great thing you can do to become a better speaker and a better leader, because you're in charge. Things change. You need to manage people, you need to influence people, you need to have the guts to push back and control and channel the whole process. So that gave me a lot of confidence to be in the moment. And if you ask me why I was, I dedicate that to being a master of ceremony, because you always get you always get surprises in being a master of ceremony, and you're always ready. You have to be in the moment. And right. I don't have experience to share on that later. Yeah.
Before we get off the call, I want the information, or maybe you can send me to a link on your webpage where I can, because I'm going to put that information along with the video. So anybody out there that's interested in, you know, being an MC, you can get it from the best right here. So we're going
to
make sure that
I'm happy to help. It's very important to be in the moment. So I realize, so you talk about impromptu speech, it's tough. Impromptu speech is tough, but again, you look at a typical tabletop, is only 1 or 2 minutes, and you survive. You know, you somehow get away. But MC is actually a longer period, so you need to practice the skill to be in the moment for a longer period. I got a lot of experience to share. Maybe another time. Yes.
Okay, so we talked about the high points.
Yes.
Tell me about a low point that you've had in Toastmasters.
All right, I had a really low point. You see, my coach said, you know, excellence is a habit and coachable. One thing I was into was I get obsessed when I write a speech. I really like writing my speeches. I spend tons of time. I practice. I get feedback. I get qualified feedback. So once I was writing my best speech ever. And we always write our best speech ever. And then realize it's not. But then I wrote the speech. I practiced everywhere. I breezed through all levels of contest, club, area, division, district. And it was at Cincinnati in 2013. And I went to US from Singapore. It cost me tons of money to go to US and also to stay longer and all the expenses. And I went early to test out whether my speech really works. So I spent money on the airfare, I spent money on the hotel, I spent money on renting a car, on the food, all of the expenses. I spent tons of money. I went to a lot of clubs, and that's where I was driving like 60 miles and 80 miles to deliver a 7-minute speech, get some feedback.
Cincinnati?
Yeah. I was initially in Pennsylvania. So I went to like Philadelphia, New Jersey, all these other places, Camden, a lot of nice people. Nice people gave me like feedback. Some counties were organizing like, you know, events to invite me to speak. I did a lot of work to just make the little things better. On stage in Cincinnati, what happened was, due to a technical human error, my microphone was switched off. So I am standing in front of 700 people, open my mouth, the microphone doesn't work. And now, okay, and of course I didn't win my contest. Of course, I did connect, but no, without, I realized without the microphone, I mean the clip-on microphone. And one thing I didn't know to do, or maybe I didn't even realize what was wrong. But then I still delivered my speech, and then I was very disappointed because I put a lot of time, effort, and money. It took me thousands of dollars. At that time, I counted like 15 or 20,000. It's like a lot of money. Because I was like staying away from work. Because I'm doing consulting work, I was doing staying away, and it was really a low point. But what really turned me around was a few things. One is I met a few three world champions in the audience who told me you should have been a champion, like fourth world champion. One of them will become a world champion later, and then this lady in the audience came to me. She's a visually challenged blind lady. She came to me and said, "Oh, that was a phenomenal speech." And because you took me on a roller coaster ride, so it was very touching. And she didn't even see my speech. And I said, "Wow!" So that really gave me a bit of lift. And I wrote a blog on that. because she didn't see my prop, she didn't see me, she listened to me, and she said, I believed I was with you. And every time I listen, and she writes to me sometimes via email with those translators, and she said, every time I think about that speech, I feel like I have to take my life on a different direction. And I believe, so I realize, okay, it's not really winning the competition, it's like those little differences you can make, and that kind of switched my viewpoint a bit as well. But of course, at that point, I was very, very angry and disappointed with the outcome, to be honest. Yeah, I'm very disappointed because, and I it really dawned on me, because I called my wife from Cincinnati to Singapore and said, you know what, my microphone didn't work. And she said, did you complain? I said, who should I complain to? And she said, go and tell the Toastmasters president. So I found, and he said, buddy, you are on your own. If your microphone fails, you are on your own. So that was like a lesson. Yeah, that's like some. But anyway, it happens. Every lesson teaches you and something. And of course, that speech now is much better than it used to be, because I, again, worked on it.
Have you ever used it again?
Oh, I used it again. That's a speech that won me the 2015. Same speech in 2015 won me the semifinals. So, yeah, it works. Of course, with slight differences here and there. So, of course, it is nothing lost. I think it was Lance Miller who tells, there are no bad days, only like new speech material.
Mm-hmm.
You know, okay. You get new speech material, yes.
So now, we're going to get down to the main event. This is what everybody is waiting to hear. We talked about a lot of different things, but you know, on these calls, we have a lot of people that they're in a lot of different positions in their journey. Either they may be thinking about, you know, competing for the first time. They may have competed before. They may have, you know, like we did, you know, had that low point to where they're trying to crawl out of it, and they say, well, you know what, I'm going to give it, you know, one last shot. I'm going to give it my heart and soul. So let's talk about speech writing. Mm-hmm. Okay. How do you, and don't leave anything out. Mm-hmm. How do you write a contest winning speech? Give us the steps on how you write a contest winning speech.
All right. Before that, let me qualify what I'm saying. I realize, and over the years, and if you do not believe what I've said, because you will, everyone, I think, eventually will realize this, is at this point, if you don't believe what it's been. Or usually I used to write speeches to win the contest. Then I realized what you really have to win is people's hearts and minds. Right? So, I'm sure various world champions would have been in this call, and they would say the same thing. Eventually, I think it's Mark Brown who said there's no direct way to the trophy, it's only through the audience's minds. And so one of my fundamental, I can go on for hours on this topic, okay, but I'm just going to try to be as brief as I can. I look at four main parameters, and this is what exactly what I teach people, and it's exactly what's there on my online home study course for world championship with a lot of the contestants use. The four elements that has to be in the speech is the following. Your speech message has to be valuable. One, valuable. That means people, there should be something of value to add. Second, it has to be relatable. That means people should be able to relate to your experience. So if you are talking about horse riding, people in the audience either have done horse riding or have someone, they need to be able to relate it. Better is if it is something they have a similar experience, because no matter what you say, people are not really listening to you. They're actually making they're thinking in certain direction, and you need to align their thinking to where it wants to be, to relate to their experience. So it has to be relatable. So that's why sometimes people give a technically perfect speech and surprise they're not winning, because it's the experience is not relatable. Third, it has to be believable. Sometimes some stories looks fantastic, but gives an impression that it's not true. You're making it up. And sometimes the speaker does a disservice by doing all these gestures and exaggerated movements to make the story interesting, but then people start doubting whether it's a real story. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying your story is not true, but the story has to be believable. I'll tell you why. I've met some world champions who have won the contest by using fictitious stories, stories that never happen. So the so being true is not in one of the contest criteria, right? So, but of course, the people say, why did they win? Because it sounded believable. But I would say always, over the years, I got better at watching people's body language and, you know, trying to predict whether it's true or not. A lot of time I accurately predict whether the person is telling the truth in terms of, because what I realize, and then even in my stories, I try to take off points that may sound not believable, even though true, but not believable. So this is very essential, because when once people have a trust in you, and so as long as you predict that it's not something true or not didn't happen, people do not listen. So, okay, so that's the third one, believable. The fourth is actionable. That means after listening to your speech, they know exactly what they can do so that they can have the similar benefits you found. So to repeat, valuable, relatable, believable, actionable. So this is like my big sheet. So if I look at the handout, what I give in the online course, it's like we put up a really big, valuable, relatable, that's my core message. And the next thing I do is I have, and the fundamental thing I do is what I call the funda, F-U-N-D-A. That means after listening to my speech, what do I want my audience to feel? What do I want the audience to unveil? U-N-V-E-I-L, unveil, as it opens. Something, I won't tell them something new they didn't know. Third is N, what do you want them to notice? That means something they know, you want to remind them, because we are not thinking of everything. You know, I want to force them to think in a certain direction. The D being what you want them to do. And when you just because you say, ask people to do something, they won't do it. So you need to tell them what they can achieve. That's an A. So what do you want them to feel, unveil, notice, do, achieve? It's on my website. It's on one of the first speaking tips. This is like my fundamental thing. And also, I try to do one thing that really helps me, not only in my contest speeches, but also in my professional speeches. I ask this question, these people are going to listen to me for so long. Am I going to give them return on time they invest on me? So I really want to give them tremendous value. I also ask myself, whatever I say, do I have the proof? Somebody is going to challenge me later. Do I have the proof? So I always make sure. See, this comes back to the believable part, because you don't want people to call you out on things, maybe by mistake or maybe by. So this is because I understand integrity is one of the important, but also credibility as a speaker, because people need to trust you all the time. And sometimes people do it unintentionally by, for example, to quote a statistics without any source or say something that really didn't happen. And then, because people also, especially in the lower level of the contest, in the club area division, people know you. So if you get on stage and try to be like someone else, you get called out instantly. They all know, oh, come on, I know who you are. Don't talk like a saint. I know who you are, right? So there is always, there's nothing wrong to be the devil or the villain, but be yourself. This is what who I am. And that vulnerability really helps. So this is like my initial parameters of crafting a story. Of course, I can go in depth by actually how I structure, but this actually matters in the sense that this really helps you connect with the audience better, because you have a real structure, you have a focus. So again, I didn't say this is to win the trophy. This is to win hearts and minds. Now, on this top, you select an experience you have. I call it the ERP. That means the experience you had in your life, and share it with a story. And when you are telling your story in the first person, what happens is the listeners are trying to relate to their stories, right? And if in the live audience, I can demonstrate this as an example. But so it's, then, of course, I tell them about my learnings, and I tell them what do they benefit by listening to me. This is my overall structure. And unless you have any specific question to ask, of course, I also go by another way. That's why how I wrote the We Can Fix It speech. I had a top-down approach, which I call the 7 steps to stardom. The 7 steps to stardom, because I wanted people to associate themselves with the phrase, "We can fix it." Right? So that was the phrase which I wanted people to really remember. And so I didn't want to change my phrase. The Craig Valentine calls it the foundational phrase. Some other speakers call it differently, but it's actually the slogan that sticks. And my kind of intention was to have that thing. And also I was doing coaching, I was helping people, because those days I'm meeting people with a lot of problems, not only on the personal level, and even at the global geopolitical level, there are a lot of problems around the world, people are fighting. And if I had more time, I would have spoken about all that thing, all those things, but I only have 7 minutes, right? And people said, yeah, we have problem with ideologies, a clash of ideologies, clash of civilization, talk about that. I said, I only have 7 minutes. So you make your own conclusions, you know? And it was very humorous speech, so it also takes a lot of time. So for example, the joke on Neha at the start, it took like 7 seconds of my time. I'm like, guys, clap faster, you know?
I was wondering about that when you did it. Were you concerned, because you got such a great laugh out of it, were you concerned about your time? How did you actually budget for that when you just did it off of the cuff?
So one thing I learned watching Brazilian Vasudev, the 2013 champion, you should watch his speech, a phenomenal speech, yeah. Reach out. And he was one of the guys who were in the audience when I my mic did fail at Cincinnati. And after he won the contest, I met him at the airport for the very first time. He's sitting, it's like 2 hours after the contest, the international speech contest in Cincinnati. I was waiting him. I saw him at the airport. I met him. He's sitting alone. I said, world champion just crowned, is sitting alone. How can that be? So I went in a chat and he said, oh, I heard about your microphone. I said, you know me? I said, how do you know me? I said, yeah, I was in the audience. And I also seen you in Florida, in Orlando, when you did the teak tree. I said, really? And so he actually had a book, notebook, where he writes comments of all the speakers. And as he flipped through a page and showed his notes about my speech. I was like, wow. And then he showed me, these are the areas. Yeah, this I like. He has highlighted. No, he not only wrote the page, he like highlighted points. I said, wow, and took a photograph of that. It was inspiring. One thing I really realized watching him, he finished his speech at 6 minutes, like 6 minutes, 10 seconds. His speech had 492 words. And I'm thinking, well, if I can write 492 words in the right order and say it in the right way, I can be the world champion. That's all it takes. And so the benefit of talking to Brazilian was he actually, I asked some open questions to him, and he shared with me his experience in competing and the thought behind crafting that speech. And I realized one of the things, I'm trying to pack too many things in my 7 minutes. And this is so sad. Even in the world championship, I find speakers who are going over time. The finals, it's a lot of hard. So I realized we need to really plan for that, those times. So there is a bigger the audience, bigger the laughter, and longer the time it will take for you to speak. And you need to budget for that. Otherwise, you will go over time. And one of the first things my coach, when I started, he said is never go over time. In fact, he said there's only three things you need to do to win a contest. First, sign up for the contest. Second, speak within time. Third, beat all other contestants. This is what he said. That's very simple. So the beat all other contestants is the longer part, but most people really get wrong in the first two. A lot of people do not even sign up for the contest, as you said. No, you need to encourage people to sign up. And the only reason you need to sign up, and again, I'm not going to promote Toastmasters or the World Championship of Public Speaking. I don't even promise that everyone can become a world champion of public speaking, because as Lance Miller said, in the next 50 years, there will be 50 world champions. But there will be thousands of, the way I looked at it was, there are millions of other speakers. There are TED Talks, there are speakers on YouTube who are doing phenomenally well. You don't really need to be in the competition, but this is an opportunity you have to speak more and get it better. So get better at this craft of speaking and get ahead. So a lot of people do not even sign up. And then, of course, people do sign up, then go over time. That's very sad. And especially okay. at the higher levels of the competition.
Let's go ahead and take a question, because I see this one like 7 or 8 times, and I'm pretty sure you hear this one a lot. Do you have to have humor in your speech?
Honestly speaking, if you follow the judgment criteria, you don't really need to have humor in your speech. But wait, this contest, the way it's designed, is not a popularity contest, not that every listener votes for or votes you. It's like 10 or 12 judges who decides whether or not you are the good speaker. Now, one thing I have done along my journey is I have analyzed the balloting process of judges, how they mark ballots. Sometimes, honestly, by sneaking in and looking next to the judge and looking at the ballot, I've done that. And I've had trouble. I've done that. I've done dumpster diving to see the ballot and take the ballot and see how. And trust me, people who you know may not mark you high. Do not count on people. So, but also, I realize the human people who making subjective judgments based on what they understood. Right now, coming back to humor, this is where it comes. See, the judge is looking, trying the best not to make a mistake. Right? So they are like patiently listening to all the contestants. And as you know, it's very difficult to listen. And even when you're listening to your speaker, not listening all the time. Now, we need to make it easier for the judge to mark us, give us points. So one thing they do, and it's an influence technique, which is called social proof. If you read this book, and highly recommend that you read Robert Cialdini's Influence, one of the steps of influence is social proof. That means if you have humor in your speech, people laugh. When people laugh, the judge looks at you, maybe he's a nice speaker. Because everybody laughed. And this is like the mind games in this contest. And there are a lot of these mind games that give you edge. But the point is, whether you like it or not, it has an influence in the judging. Colin Williams, one of my co-contestants at the Cincinnati semifinal, he said you enter the game knowing all the rules. You know the judges are making subjective judgments. You know that the results may not be in your favor. But then what I realized also is, you need to make it easier for them to mark you up. This is why you see contestants talking in ways they will never talk, never speak to impress the judges. Which is sad in certain ways, but also one of the easier and cleaner ways to do that is to use humor. And as long as this humor is related to the story, related to the experience, it becomes easier. So some people force fit the humor. Like tell a joke now, but it's actually, if you can uncover the humor along as the story is uncovered, I think it becomes more natural. Then you actually will start loving it. And you also want to make it easier for the audience to listen. So sometimes a serious speech with a blend of humor becomes more pleasant to hear. So one of the challenges I faced, well, I was a very serious speaker. I had no humor in my speech. I give like this profound messages, and I was like giving profound messages, and people say, oh, that's a great message. But then once I started doing stand-up comedy and humor, I found a way to blend these two things. It took me a long time to do that, and one of the reasons I did is I was at those days trying to be a professional speaker. So I was actually reaching out to people who are professional speakers, highly successful, and learning from them. And I send 2 speeches to them. One is my Toastmasters speech, and another one is my stand-up comedy. And this is my speech. Take a look. Will I be a professional speaker? and the gentleman, he looked at me, looked at the speech, and wrote me mail. You never speak like that Toastmasters speech. You never do that. You're so fake. It looks like you guys have like 2 languages, because you say 3 things, then you put the hand also 3 things. Your gestures are so forced. And then I realized maybe he has a point. So I looked at this speech from an objective perspective and say, yeah, maybe I need to make it easier for listeners to listen and be more natural. So stand-up comedy is more natural without the theatrical tricks of movement, unnecessary. It's actually wordplay. And so I learned how, and of course worked hard to see how I can blend it in. So to as a short answer, yes, no, I mean, yes and no, because the judgment crisis criteria doesn't say it has to be humorous, but it gives you an edge.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much. We're going to go ahead and close out. We got like 3 minutes left. So what would be this is your parting words for everybody that is a Manoj fan. What is your parting words for them? Me as well.
I believe, sorry, Jose, for you as well. Sure.
I'm your fan.
Oh, thank you, Joel. And see, I believe we are living in a world where one person can stand up and speak and be a positive influence in this world. All you need to do is stand up and speak, put it on YouTube, be available. This is a powerful, powerful gift that you have, that the gift to speak. And every time we speak, we get this unique opportunity to maybe not to change the world, at least to be a positive influence in this world, to make the world slightly better. And so take this very seriously, because this actually, you treat every speech you will make as a message to the world, because there will be somebody out there in the audience, like the blind lady in my audience, Cincinnati, somebody who have to hear that speech. Even with the speech, we can fix it. I mean, of course, it didn't give me the tallest trophy. What it did for me was this message went far and wide. It got shared on YouTube, on other social media messages, WhatsApp. And a lot of people have watched, all the way from Mexico to Malaysia to Maryland to Melbourne. People have messaged me. I just realized, so if I knew it will go that far, I would have done it better. That's what I thought. You know, if I knew a lot of people are going to watch this, I should have done it better. So my parting message is the following. To be a better speaker, you better speak. Because by speaking, you not only deliver better speeches, you'll become a better person. And you will sooner or later realize that the audience is the most important component of your speech. And to send out positive messages not only enriches yourself, not only your listener, it actually makes the world a better place.
Wow. Thank you so much. Guys, listen, this has been great. His book, as well as all of his coaching services, are going to be in the message box at the bottom. So make sure you check it out. Manoj, I want to thank you again. Thank you for taking the time out. Congratulations to you on all your success. Take care and God bless you.
Thank you, Joel. Thank you, Joel. And at this moment, I remember when I first saw you, maybe I don't share that one minute of story. I was in Cincinnati. No, it was in Washington, D.C. at last August. I was walking along the streets trying to look for, in the middle of the night, looking for a pharmacy. And I meet this guy on the road. I don't know who he is. I asked him for the direction. He generously showed me the direction. And a few months later, he called me and said, hey, can you be on my call? Thank you so much, Joel. I really appreciate you doing
Not
this.
A problem. It was my pleasure.
Because you are actually coming back from, by the way, Joel is also a contestant and was a highly reputed speaker, and he has come back to bring messages for other people to be better. And I think you're doing an amazing job. Thank you so much, and glad to be on this call. And
thank you. Thank you so much, man. Take care. Bye-bye.